time for our responsive reading, and this is a weekly practice that we do together as a church at Beacon to confess together the truths that unite us as believers and followers of Jesus Christ. We use material from a resource called New City Catechism, which is a form of questions and answers that help guide us through the scriptural truths of Christianity. And we do not hold that resource to be authoritative in any way. Rather, we use it to point us to God's Word, which we do believe to be authoritative. So our question this week is, why must the Redeemer be truly God? If you remember back to last week, Adam taught us why the Redeemer must be truly human. Adam read for us, and we considered scriptures that showed that Jesus, the Redeemer, must have been fully human so that he could properly and fully represent us. And also, it means that he sympathizes with our weakness. So if you've been part of this church for a long time, you've been following and participating in this responsive reading series, you will be aware that the moral position, the human condition, is far from rosy. Understatement. We find ourselves far short of God's moral standards. We disobey his moral law, and we do not do the good works that his goodness and his holiness require. We do not even love God or honor God properly as he deserves, according to his perfect glory and majesty. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, "For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." So Jesus, it says the Redeemer here, did not know sin. So all the ways that we fail to keep God's law, to honor God, this verse here says that Jesus did that perfectly. Romans 5:19 says, "For as by the one man's disobedience, the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience, the many will be made righteous." And Philippians 2:8, "He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross." So these verses stress the obedience of Christ, his righteousness, and also the transfer of that righteousness from Christ to his people. So our redemption requires both payment for our sin, but it also requires a perfect fulfilling of God's law, perfect righteousness before God. And we can't achieve that righteousness by ourselves. So Jesus lived a perfect life, and he transfers that, or imputes, is the kind of Christianese or like academic term for that, but he transfers that righteousness onto us. So what sort of Redeemer could be perfectly obedient and righteous? What was it about Jesus that he was able to be obedient? We know that we're not able to be obedient. We're humans, and we struggle with a sin nature. We understand that, yes, it's impossible to be perfect. So what was special about Jesus that he was perfect? Because Romans 3:10 says, "None is righteous, no, not one." And Romans 3:23, "All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." And Jesus says in Mark 10, "No one is good except God alone." So in order for the Redeemer to be perfectly obedient and righteous, that Redeemer must be God. The entirety of Scripture from Genesis to Revelation shows that since the fall in Genesis 3, every human being is under the curse of sin, in need of redemption. We see that those who try to exert their own power of self-righteousness actually resist God, to their own ruin. But those who humble themselves and trust God's promises receive Christ's righteousness. So Jesus was fully God. That's how he was able to perfectly be obedient and keep God's law and fully honor God as he deserves. Also, what kind of Redeemer could bear the penalty for so much sin? There is an infinite amount of sin in the world. It's truly crushing. God sees it all. Isn't he patient? God knows the heart of every man. He sees all the sinful acts. For thousands of years, that is a lot of sin. And isn't one sin against the infinite God more than any one of us could bear? God loves justice and hates sin. Who could bear so much sin? Isaiah 61:8 says, "For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and iniquity." So, our sin, since the history of mankind is immeasurable, and because God hates sin, there's an immeasurable amount of penalty, pain, and wrath against that sin. But First Peter 2:24 says, "He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed." Says that Jesus poured this wrath on our behalf and went to the grave, but God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. Acts 2:24. It was not possible for Jesus to be held by death because he was truly God. Jesus was God, he was infinite, and so he was able to fully bear infinite amount of wrath against sin on our behalf. So please join, please stand and join me in responding. We won't be able to display it on the screen, I'm sorry. But if you believe and confess these truths, you can listen to the answer and affirm it with an amen or something like that. So the question is, why must the Redeemer be truly God? That because of his divine nature, his obedience and suffering would be perfect and effective. And also that he would be able to bear the righteous anger of God against sin and yet overcome death. Let's pray. Lord, just as one trespass, disobeying you in the garden, led to condemnation for all, so one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for us. The act of Jesus Christ's obedience unto death, we praise you this morning for intervening in our hopelessness. Our guilt was greater than any of us could bear. But Lord Jesus, you came as a man to represent us, fully human, but with the capacity to bear the sin of the world because you are also fully God. As your word teaches us, you resist the proud but give grace to the humble. May we be humble this morning as we receive the preaching of your word, and may your word change our hearts, minds,